It's time for Twit This Week in Tech. Great panel for you. Will Harris from the UK, Katie Benner from the New York Times, and Jason Snell from Six Colors stops by and talks about lots of things. The Samsung paying Apple $500 million, but they want a money-back guarantee. We'll talk about the hacker who got into VTech and the hackable Barbie. Plus, Mark Zuckerberg, is he really giving away 99% of his fortune, or is it all a scam? It's all coming up next on Twit.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Twit, This Week in Tech, episode 539, recorded Sunday, December 6th, 2015. Data mining Barbie. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Citrix GoToMeeting, the powerfully simple way to meet with coworkers and clients from the convenience of your computer, smartphone, or tablet. Share the same screen and see each other face-to-face with HD video conferencing. For a 30-day free trial, visit GoToMeeting.com today. And by Stamps.com. Start using your time more effectively with Stamps.com. Use Stamps.com to buy and print real U.S. postage the instant you need it right from your desk. To get our special offer, go to Stamps.com now. Click on the microphone and enter Twit. And by Harry's. For guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction of what you're paying now, go to Harry's. Get $5 off your first purchase by entering the code TWIT5 when you check out. And by Audible.com. Sign up for the Platinum Plan and get 2 free books. Go to audible.com/twit2. And don't forget to follow Audible on Twitter. User ID audible_com. It's time for Twit This Week in Tech, the show where we talk about the latest tech news with the best people in the biz. Oh, forget it. It's not the best people in the biz. It's just my favorite people in the biz. Let's be honest about that. People like Jason Snell. Actually,
can't we be both, Leo?
We could be both. But I don't. I want to make it clear. I don't choose you because of your esteemed position as the editor-in-chief of SixColors.com, former editorial director at IGG. I choose you because I like you.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Same thing with Katie Benner. Sure, she's at the nation's paper of record, the New York Times. But she's also just a great person.
Aw, thanks.
Hi, Katie. Actually, nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Jason, I heard a rumor he was actually choosing you based on your looks. So,
well, yeah, he's right.
Throwing that out there.
I can categorically deny these rumors.
I am in love with Jason Snell. Will Harris is here. I pick him just because he has only one L in his will.
And to provide some transatlantic perspective,
yes,
once again. It's good to be back, Leo.
It's been ages. Will's now head of digital at Condé Nast Britain. This is the fourth job Will has held since he started appearing on Twit.
This shows you how long we've been doing this.
That's more. It's more really a reflection on the amount of time we've been doing Twit. Anyway, great to have you all here. Especially nice because we can talk about tech, the toy store, instead of talking about guns, mm-hmm, and depressing, sad stories of which there are an ample supply. Sometimes I kind of appreciate that I'm not a general reporter covering day-to-day news, but we only cover the fun stuff, the toy store. Nevertheless, our hearts and prayers go out to people in San Bernardino. A terrible tragedy there, just on the heels of Paris. Seems a never-ending saga. You're using an iPad Pro. See how that cheers you up immediately?
There it is.
Giant iPad.
It's a freakishly large iPad.
It is.
It's like those giant checks they give to people who win the lottery.
It feels like a tea tray. Yeah, it is.
It is.
Yeah, it's a demo iPad.
It's like a clipboard, actually. When you carry it, it's like you're carrying a clipboard.
And you have opted not to go with the also massive Logitech Creative Keyboard, but I see you're using the Apple kind of a slender keyboard.
Today I am. I thought it would be nicer on camera.
It's more portable, too.
Although, honestly, I'm really liking, I still have my old Apple Bluetooth keyboard and the in-case origami, which is a little thing that folds out.
Yeah,
and
all
it's
you
a
need
stand.
Is a stand, yeah.
And I like it better because it's a regular old mechanical keyboard as opposed to this kind of strange strange keyboard.
No here. Pencil today?
No pencil today. I left it at home. Is it behind my ear? No, I left it at home.
It really bugs me that Apple provided no affordance for storing that pencil in any way. Not a clip you could put in your pocket, not a magnet you could put on the side.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think this is the Surface Book, and it has a nice magnetic, it's just good strong magnet. That pen is not going anywhere. And I kind of like that. It just seems like a sensible thing. By the way, this is hot, which means it is still prey to the problem Microsoft has identified but not fixed. They say not till next year of just kind of randomly being on.
Well, you know.
And people report, I put the Surface Book in my backpack and it got really, really hot and the battery died. Because it never really the screen's off, but it never just
that,
it never
that
stops.
Used to happen to my MacBook Pro all the time a few years ago.
These things are hard.
Power management is tricky.
Microsoft says it's really Intel's fault. The new Sky. This is one of the first Skylake machines. Who snorted?
Blame Intel. not us.
Long tradition between Microsoft and Intel. In fact, I'll never forget interviewing Andy Grove. Remember him when he was the CEO of Intel? And he said, it's all Microsoft's fault. We make great 64-bit chips, and they keep giving us these crap operating systems. So it's never ending. It's a never ending saga.
It's always Andy Grove.
I loved Andy Grove. Whatever happened to him? He was a great story. He was a Hungarian refugee who tells the story of crawling on his through a minefield and barbed wire to get out of Hungary in the 50s, when of course it was still a Soviet satellite. Crawling through a minefield to get out of Hungary, came to the United States. There's, you know, not to get political, but there's so many great stories of people who emigrated here and really made a difference in the United States.
One of my friends in elementary school, his parents were Hungarian immigrants. Same story. One of them fled when the revolution
1956,
failed.
1956,
If you haven't read any of Andy Grove's books, they are all pretty phenomenal. Great books on management and great books on, you know, how he built, you know, one of the most important companies of the 20th century. And easy to read as well. Definitely worth picking up.
Only the Paranoid Survive, was that one of them? Something like that?
Only the Paranoid Survive is a good one. Yeah. And then the other one is about leadership, and I can't think of what it's called now, but it's a really good read.
Katie, did you get your phone back yet?
Oh, no. So eBay's still trying to figure it out. What had happened is my phone was stolen, and somebody bought it on eBay and very kindly called me and said, I have it.
How did they know it was yours? Was your stuff still on it?
No, I had a lock screen, so I had to break the phone, and it said, please call this number if you find the phone. So I get this call yesterday. Such a nice person. And I said, okay, well, let's figure out a way for you to get your money back first, because that's the most important thing at this point, and then we'll figure out a way to get it back, because my work phone is property of the New York Times. And then eBay, they called the seller to let the seller know that the buyer...
The seller? You mean the guy who stole your phone, seller?
So the seller immediately messaged the buyer of the phone and was like, I'll give you your money back. Just send the phone back to me. Don't report it. I know. Totally insane. Totally insane. So I did reach out to eBay and I said, hey, how do we get this taken care of so this nice, honest person gets his money back and I can return this phone, which is now broken also. He was also sold a broken phone. Get this broken phone back to my office. So, and I haven't figured it out yet.
A little note to crooks who watch Twit. I know there's lots of you. Don't steal iPhones. You can't do anything with them.
I know. You end up selling them on eBay to unsuspecting people.
They have a kill switch, right?
Yeah.
You couldn't get rid of Katie Benner's lock screen, could you? No. He tried to break it. I bet you that's why it's broken.
It was like that scene in Zoolander where they're like, the files are in the computer and they start shaking the computer. Like, I'll just break this screen.
How do I get Katie out of this phone? There's got to be a way.
I heard that one of the reasons they ask for you to, when you take a phone to be fixed at the Apple store, they ask you to unlock it and turn off Find My iPhone. One of the reasons they want to do that is they want to verify that it's your phone and you have a password to it. Because so that would be a way around, right? Like, oh, it doesn't work. Get me a new one. And then you've got a
Because Apple has some way of unlocking it, right?
Yeah. I always found that really weird, but I guess that's why.
And you can't turn on Find My iPhone unless you have a password.
Yeah, right.
Your Apple account.
It may also be because Apple isn't that great at at dealing with phones that haven't been properly logged out and keeps them around as kind of ghosts. Okay. But that's my understanding, is that it may be in part because they want to verify that you actually own that device.
So what's the latest from eBay? They say you, what are they telling you?
They're working it out. I think that originally they gave the buyer, who was really trying to do the right thing, when he went to them, because he's not a reporter, when he went to them, he got, well, if this hasn't been reported to the police and it doesn't show up on checkmend.com, which is a phone verification website that I can't imagine many people are using. He's like, if it doesn't show up, there's no way to prove it was stolen. And it's just, you got to send it back to the seller and get your money back from him and work it out with him. This guy who's like a thief, possibly.
Oh,
and of course, the gentleman didn't want to send it back to the seller. He thought that was wrong. So he got back in touch with me and let me know what was going on. And I said, you know what? We'll figure it out.
You got an honest guy.
Get your money back. Yeah, he's really honest. He's a nice person.
How much did he pay?
He paid $100.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he fixes iPhone screens. So when in the description it said that the screen was cracked, he thought, oh, that's no big deal. I can fix that, and then I'll have a working phone. He was buying it for a friend's mother for Christmas because she didn't have a smartphone. So he's a nice person.
Everybody's nice in this except for the thief.
I know.
And who is eBay favoring? The thief!
Well, they're still working it out, so we'll see.
Interesting story. You'd think with... you know, your clout, and I know you've brought this to Twitter, so it's in public, that they would respond more quickly, but...
They're being quick. I just don't really know. I don't know. I don't want to criticize them too harshly until so we figure out
it might
out
come
app
out okay. Yeah.
Exactly.
As long as we're talking iPhones, we should talk a little Apple news. Samsung says we're going to pay the amount that the court has dinged us for in the patent dispute. And it's not the full amount, is it, Katie? $548 million. Wasn't it over $1 billion originally?
Right, so originally, but a lot of the pieces of the case were dismissed or things stopped being relevant. So the number got whittled down and whittled down. I love this story so much. I really want, like, Tim Cook and Phil Schiller to be photographed outside Apple HQ holding, like, one of those big checks from publishers. Yeah.
They could put it on an iPad at Pro and be perfect.
So the way I view this is that it's going to be, Samsung's going to pay entirely in coins.
Wasn't that the rumor?
Right. They're going to bring it all in coins.
They had a dump truck of nickels.
And then Apple will give them back some Apple Store credit. Just to be as passive aggressive
as possible.
Samsung
says, we'll pay it, but we also want to be able to get it back if the judgment is reversed, modified, vacated, or set aside on appeal, which I think doesn't seem unfair, but I guess that's not how these things work.
And it's also sort of setting the company up for bringing the case somewhere else. And when you think, where else could they possibly bring it? One of those places is the Supreme Court, which they nod to in their statement as well. Right. So I think that we can probably expect some sort of move on Samsung's part to bring this case before the Supreme Court.
Wow. Samsung's called the amount Apple's grossly exaggerated damages claim. And frankly, it is, because it'd be pretty hard to prove that Apple lost $500 million in iPhone sales because of Samsung's crappy copies. And it was the first Samsung phones that looked, yeah, admittedly, were copied from the iPhone. But I doubt that it cost Apple $500 million in damages.
Well, it got Apple. It got Android in the game, right?
Yeah.
So even if that generation of phones didn't sell very well, it was the generation of phones that proved Android could make something that was even vaguely comparable, which then set the market up to go forward. I think if you were Steve Jobs, you'd probably be thinking that half a billion was an absolute steal, right? You know.
Well, Apple wanted $2.5 billion in the original lawsuit. They said it'll be $2.5 billion, please. I don't know how much of that is damages and how much of that is statutory. Probably mostly damages, right, Katie?
Yeah, and there were some things that were also dropped as well, like to other people's points, things like pinch to zoom. Apple just really, you know, that patent, they said that's just not something that you can say really was just yours. So
slide to unlock was another one, right?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see what happens as these companies continue to drag out what is a drop in the bucket in terms of money for both of them.
Yeah, well, certainly for Apple, although Samsung's phone sales haven't been great of late. It might be that, like, I can't say they need the money. They still make bulldozers. and refrigerators.
And chips.
And ships.
Full of money.
But half a... hey, even for a giant keretsu, it's a half a billion. It's not insignificant.
Isn't that a waste of all of our time and all the company's time and money to do this whole thing?
What is the cost, the court costs? Yeah. What are the costs that we, the people, are paying for this? And I think it was became very clear. And in fact, I have to say, Tim Cook has kind of toned this war down considerably. But it was clear there was some cost to Apple. And just in the discovery phase, in the revelations about how Apple works, that they really didn't want people to know. I think that that's a bigger cost in some ways to Apple.
Yeah, I agree. You know, this was Steve Jobs being angry, and I think maybe rightfully so, about feeling like they got ripped off by Samsung and that Samsung was building their business on something that was a ripoff of an Apple product. I think that's all true, but to go nuclear, as he said, and do this, there are no winners here.
Absolutely. And you shouldn't let emotion like that run a business. That's a risky... Although... Gosh, you can't knock anything Steve Jobs did. He certainly, whatever he did, it worked.
Well, I don't think
say, I think letting emotion run the business was the Steve Jobs motto.
Yeah,
and you got to take the good with the bad there. Yeah. But this was, I would put this in the bad column where he's got a vendetta against them, and it's not necessarily going to do anything good for Apple, but he feels like, you know, he felt it was right to do this, so they did it.
Kudos for Apple to Apple. They open sourced Swift. They said they would when they announced Swift. Swift is a new programming language Apple designed initially for writing software for Macintoshes and iOS, but they have now quite literally open sourced it. And that means...
And it's a good week for open source, right? Because Microsoft has just done the same thing with the Edge engine.
Yes, the browser engine, it's called, what is it, Karma? What is the name of the browser engine? Kathmandu? It'll come to me. It's interesting how my brain works. It's with a K. So Swift... Well, already we've seen it's on GitHub. We've already seen, I think, a Linux implementation. In fact, I found a really cool site.
Is it the playground at IBM?
Yeah, IBM is doing a Swift sandbox. They already have it up and running. So you can go to IBM Swift sandbox and literally type in Swift code online and see the output.
Yeah, it all runs, you know, it's running on the server and you can put the Swift code in there. And it's a pretty cool idea. You know,
it's a great idea.
Whether it... spreads far and wide or not, it is a nice gesture by Apple to make it open source.
You know, one of the things that's really great about Swift is not part yet of this, and that's the playground. The playground is a great teaching tool. As we get, this is the week of code, of course, the hour of code this week, code.org, trying to get kids all over the world, not just the U.S., to spend at least an hour learning to code. And Swift is really great for that because of this playground, which gives you an opportunity to kind of like this, see your code run and mess around with it in a graphical way.
And the way Swift is structured, my understanding, I'm not a programmer, my understanding is that it's actually pretty good for education because kids can get going fairly quickly and see the effects of small changes in their code without a lot of the code overhead that's required for some more complex languages that are more familiar.
And of course, it would be great for Apple if more people were coding in what will be, I think, its official language. There's issues with Objective-C. We talked about this on Security Now, and I've never really verified it. Maybe you could ask your developer friends. Steve Gibson says one of the problems with security on iOS comes down to Objective-C and the way it resolves function names. It's possible to hide access to internal functions, to non-published functions in an app because you don't have to call them by name. You can hash the name. And Objective-C, there's no way to turn that off. It's just part of how it resolves function names. He says we've already seen an exploit based on that. He says that's not going to be the end of it. There's going to be a lot more. So maybe Apple, knowing this, is anxious to move off of Objective-C.
Well, and Objective-C, I mean, this goes back to the next days. This is the reason Objective-C is the development tool of choice for iOS and OS X is because it was the development tool of choice, the programming language of choice for Next Step back in the day. And when OS X came out, there was a long progression, but pretty much now you need to use Xcode and you basically need to use Objective-C. And Swift is the... you know, eventual replacement and is simpler and is higher level and has a lot of features that just weren't there or weren't available or weren't practical when Next Step was being worked on. But that was a long time ago. So, you know, in the background, they worked for whatever, 5 years, something like that on Swift. And And, you know, what I hear from developers is that for certain tasks, it is fantastic, but it's also new and it's still growing and they're still making changes. They did a 2.0 version of the language spec that actually sort of changed some of the rules, which on one level, if you learn to write in Swift and then they change the rules, that's scary. But on another level, it shows that they're listening and they want to progress the language and not just sort of say, oh, well, we made a mistake. We can never go back, right. Which would be
problematic. They were very clear about that when Swift 1.0 came out. This is an unfinished language.
Yeah, it will change, and it has.
Swift 2.0 is current. It seems like, though, there's also boasting rights. Every company has to have its own language. You know, Microsoft's got C Sharp, Apple's got Swift, Google's got Go, Yahoo's got Brooklynese. I don't know what Yahoo's got. They got nothing. hey, forget about it. I want to talk about what's going on at Yahoo, because that's an interesting story. Also, the grand unified theory of Apple products. And John Gruber, in a surprising breach of his relationship with Apple, says the Mac App Store is rotting. Rotting. Wow.
Is that what that smell was?
Wow. I got a fun panel here. It's going to be fun. Will Harris from London. His new digs with fiber. Nice. What time is it in London? It's like midnight, 11:30. Oh, you muted yourself, my friend.
Yeah, 11:30.
11:30.
That 100 meg feels pretty good for me.
Yeah, very nice. Katie Benner from New York City. We knew she arrived because we heard the sirens.
Oh, no, I'm in San Francisco.
Oh, you're in San Francisco. I'm sorry. New York Times. I'm very literal.
Well, okay, we have sirens here too.
Yeah, sirens everywhere. Yeah. This is a nice view. I like the wood window behind you and everything. It's very pretty.
Oh yeah, it's my non-working fireplace.
Oh, it's not a window, it's a fireplace. Every San Francisco flat has to have a non-working fireplace.
Exactly. Jason, it's very quaint.
Yes. And on a rainy day in San Francisco, we finally have winter.
Yeah.
Jason Snell is also here.
The other season, one of our two seasons that we have.
Summer and winter. Our show today brought to you by those great folks at Citrix who make GoToMeeting the easiest, most powerful way to meet with your coworkers and clients all around the world. You don't want to have to travel. You know, more and more, Wes, we work with people all over the world, San Francisco, London, and meeting with people over the phone can be so dry and deadly. But with GoToMeeting, you can see the screen. They can see your screen. You could trade back and forth. Great for presentations. You could see them with HD quality webcams. And you can do that all on not just your computer, but your tablet, your smartphone. You can even present from your iPad, which is amazing. That means you can sit out in the garden, enjoy a beautiful day or the rain, and boom. It's also really easy to start a meeting. You just send out an email. They click a link. Even if they've never used GoToMeeting before, they're up and running within seconds. I love it. You could get up and running right now for free. If you go to GoToMeeting.com and click the Try It Free button, you'll literally be ready for your first meeting in a minute or two. And then start a meeting. You're going to love it. We don't like doing meetings without GoToMeeting. I won't do conference calls anymore. I want to see people. I want to see their screens. It's much more engaging. GoToMeeting.com. Try it free for 30 days. Just go to GoToMeeting.com and click the Try It Free button. I saw this. I don't know what to think of it, but I thought with Jason Snell here, we could talk about it. This is from a Apple blog called Above Avalon.
Yeah, Neil Seibert.
The Grand Unified Theory of Apple Products.
It's interesting. He's parsing some things that Phil Schiller, Apple's VP of product marketing, has talked about in an interview and sort of put it in line. It's interesting to see, you know, with Apple, sometimes you've got to look at what their statements are and try to divine from that what their thought
Kremlinology,
processes are
behind
it. It is Kremlinology. We are reading the tea leaves here. And in this case, it's how they describe these individual products. And it's an interesting way to look at it, which is they sort of say the watch is for things that you used to be able to do on the phone. The phone is for things that you could do on the iPad. The iPad's for things you could do on a laptop. The laptop's for things you could do on the desktop. And the desktop is for us to invent new things. And that's literally what they seem to be saying.
That kind of makes sense. It all has this cascade, this lateral flow. And it's
like,
you know,
Russian
there's a
nesting dolls.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, what are the
babushkas?
Matryoshkas. It kind of makes sense because, and you almost need this because you wonder, well, how does the watch fit into this overall scheme? And I think there's some concern because Apple's, remember when Steve Jobs came back to Apple? The first thing he did was slash product lines.
Right.
He very famously went up to the whiteboard, drew a big plus sign, and said, we're going to have four quadrants, business, consumer, portable, desktop. And that's it.
That's it.
Anything that doesn't fit into that is gone. And he killed many, many product lines and always said the most important word in business is no. Remember, what was this? One of the biographies? Or maybe Johnny Ive, I think he mentioned this in an interview. He said every day Steve would come to me and say, how many times did you say no today, Johnny? And he wanted to hear a big number. Well, in the 4 years since Jobs passed away, Apple has doubled the number of products from 12 to 24. And if you take in the various SKUs, it's even more. I mean, it's really gotten fairly complicated. Neil points out that part of this is just Apple's ability to manage a supply chain better, an ability to manufacture better. But it's nice to hear that there's still a rationale. Maybe you don't have a quadrant, but there's a rationale behind what Apple's doing. Does this make sense to you?
I think so. I mean, again, how much of this is marketing and how much of this is what they think behind the scenes? What criminologists like to believe is that Apple's statements to the public can be reverse engineered to be something about the understanding about how they run their business.
Yeah. See, I don't think so.
And I think it's part of it, but it's not the whole picture. What's that I think I'm quoting Doctor Who here, where I say that a footprint doesn't look like a boot, right? Just because there's a footprint there, it doesn't mean you know what boot the person was wearing and what the shape of the boot was. And I think there's a little of that going on here. But look, this is the only information we have to their behavior and their statements to the press that we can use to understand sort of like, what does Apple think their business is and where are they going and why do they make the decisions they make? And so that's why criminology happens.
Very important, though, I think, to realize that Apple is incredibly savvy in how they present themselves. I feel like there's no statement coming out of Apple that isn't with intent behind it.
That's one of the nice things about this Above Avalon piece is that when you parse what is said, you can see that it is very disciplined. You can see that every statement that Phil Schiller makes about every product is parallel with the others. Like, there are talking points, and everybody knows what to say. And when they ask who's the Apple Watch for, they have an answer, and it's going to be the same answer. And they're very disciplined about that. In fact, again, we talk about Steve Jobs and how when you have Steve Jobs, you get what you get, good and bad. He was the most undisciplined person in some ways. He would say all sorts of crazy stuff from time to time because he was mad or because he wanted to. And Tim Cook's Apple, super disciplined.
Well, and you see how hard that is to do when you look at a company like Microsoft, which will say contradictory things within 5 minutes of one another, or Google, same thing. It's a little easier to see a through line in everything Apple says and everything Apple makes. One of the questions I still have, and I think Neil addresses this in his post, is the watch. He says, while we did have to reset expectations after the watch came out, he says, I continue to think the Apple Watch is being underestimated, that people don't see it where it's headed. Now, I'm wearing an Apple Watch, but I've said myself, it feels like a flop. It feels like it didn't live up to its promise, and it's more complicated. Yeah, there's another one. Katie, you have one. Oh, look, we have the same one, Will. Look.
Yeah. I'm not wearing mine right now.
But you have
I didn't
one.
Want to be bothered by the alerts.
See? And, of course, Jason's wearing one.
I got mine.
So, but we're not a good sample.
No, we're not. But at the same time, we may also be not a good sample about whether it's a flop or not. I mean, it sounds like the sales figures are pretty good.
They are. Maybe a million a month, according to some analysts' guess.
And so then it's about what your expectations are.
Yeah.
I think it's just so early, right? We have this vision that whenever Apple comes out with anything, it's going to be perfect from day one. It's going to revolutionize our lives from day one. And actually, we have that idea of it, and it's never been the case. Like, that's never happened. Like, when the iPhone came out, it took years to revolutionize our lives while they had the App Store, right? When the iPad came out, it was just like an iPhone you know, you remember they had the thing where you could double the size of apps so that you could use like apps that weren't out on iPad. You could still use the iPhone versions. I mean, that was a horror show. And yet we still sort of continue to think that Apple's going to release something that's going to be fully formed and perfect from day one. I think this is, you know, much better than the iPad was on day one. It's much better than the iPhone was on day one. Is it as good as the iPhone or the iPad are now? Absolutely not. Will it get there? You know, I'm absolutely convinced it will, and I agree with the guys on the blog. Like, I think it's completely underestimated.
You agree,
I think it's
Katie?
Interesting too to see this in light of the comments that Angela Ahrendts made. She was at the Fast Company Festival in New York City, and it's really one of the first times they'd put her out in public. It's been very odd trying to figure out what
it is. I keep expecting her to show up on stage somewhere,
and so she finally does, yeah. And if you look at the context of, well, this is what all the different products are for, and these are the kinds of people they're for, her push was really more around productivity, like how she wants to rearrange the stores by how we'll use the products or what use cases they can solve, whether that's music or making music or videos or business tasks, and how each product can somehow fit into our lives in the way that we get up and work and live. So something like the watch, that feels very much to me like a product that just hasn't really found its use case yet. I mean, how long has the iPad existed? And only now are we seeing it being given a real business tool purpose with the accessories necessary and the size necessary for people who are architects or designers to really use the iPad. And that's just happening now. But I think that there's a chance that could be successful, right? So the watch is, for us, we had high expectations for it because we own a lot of Apple stuff. And we wanted it to be as cool as our phones are. But for somebody who doesn't own a lot of Apple products or is new to the company, for them, it will probably be a much more natural process of, oh, I wonder what I can do with this in my daily life. Like, maybe my watch is going to be the thing that I only use for business purposes because I like the way it reminds me for meetings. Every 20 minutes, I'm never late again. Right. And that in and of itself is a wonderful tool that maybe somebody who is using their MacBook for music doesn't care about.
That for me has changed my life, by the way. I always tell people the Apple Watch makes me like a way more polite person, because rather than checking my phone every 10 minutes when I'm in a meeting, if I get a little tap on my wrist, I know it's time to go and there's no need for me to be looking at anything else apart from the person or the thing that I'm supposed to be doing. It'd be worth it just for that, in my view. And I know that's like a really niche use case, but actually that's a niche use case that a lot of people wouldn't appreciate unless you ever actually tried it, right?
Right. And if you're looking at life in the bigger context of, okay, what's productivity for me and what is business for me, there's your use case for the watch. Say you're not that person. Say you're a physician. Maybe there's a use for the watch that's totally different from timekeeping. Or if you're an artist, there might be a use for it that's totally different. And again, it's just going to be a matter of those purposes coming together over time with experimentation and app developers creating tools that we'll like or we won't.
I'm open to that notion, but I think like the iPad Pro, the Apple Watch is a concept that's yet to be proven. It's all potential. I started wearing again. Well, I'll give you an example. We flew to Vegas on Thursday, and I thought coming home, you know, I really should put the boarding pass in my phone and then transfer it over to my watch. And the only people who are going to do this, I think, having done it now, are people who are really kind of geeks who are dedicated to getting this thing working, because it's not as convenient, I'm be completely honest, as going up to the kiosk, printing out your boarding pass and carrying it. You have to kind of fuss with it as you're walking up the line and make sure it's on the screen, and then it's on the watch, and you have to, and then you can't, this is Virgin America, can't fit the watch under the scanner.
Right, but
so
that's
you
an argument against mobile boarding passes in general, right? Paper is easy.
It's just easy. It works.
So that's maybe an
so
argument
it's not
against
a
the phone.
Indictment
for
of the
too.
Watch. But I feel like many of the things that we go, oh, this is really great, we say it's great because we're geek enough to devote the energy involved and to put up with the inconvenience involved. And I don't think a normal person is going to, I feel like the potential is unrealized. I really do.
I think you're smoking crack, Leo.
I'd like to be right now, but
I think I see people flying I'd fly a lot, right, for work. And
Do you use electronic boarding passes?
Yeah, absolutely. because you get, you know, if you have something like the British Airways app or the Virgin app that's integrated with Passbook, you get a little reminder that says, hey, do you want to check in? And you swipe and you check in online, and it says, hey, do you want to add this boarding pass to your Passbook? And you go, yeah, sure. And then as soon as you get to the airport, it pops up on your screen and you're like, oh, okay, it's right here on my screen as soon as I walk into the terminal. And I see more and more and more and more people doing that. You know, when I'm queuing up for a domestic flight now or like a European flight, I see, you know, at least maybe 20% of the people with mobile boarding passes on their phones.
I'll grant you that a lot of people use it. And it's very annoying because they slow the whole line down.
And regular people. but I think that, you know, I don't think it's going to be geeks that...
Same thing with Apple Pay, by the way. They slow the whole line down. They don't speed the line up.
My Apple Pay, I am super speedy and I speed the line up. And you know why? Because I use Apple Pay on my Apple Watch.
You go,
tap,
and I'm out of there.
All right.
Yep.
Well, I'm open to the idea. But it's interesting what you say, Katie, about Angela's comments are exactly, as you said, Jason, in alignment with this whole notion of the watch will grow into tasks that the phone does right now, but you will find more useful on the watch. My only, when I say flop, I don't mean a sales flop. I don't judge a new technology product by sales. I'm not a business reporter. I'm judging it by utility, applicability, to what purpose. And
it hasn't made itself indispensable to you.
And so I understand I'm also an individual case. I'm not a universal case. But I try to look at it with a kind of a universal mind. It's fiddly. There's touch. There's a knob. There's a button. The UI is complex, maybe overly complex. I feel that there, and as Ken from Chicago said in our chat room, this is one of the first Apple products we've seen. He says they didn't have a cohesive story about how people would use it. They just said, here's some features, you know.
No, they sprayed use cases against
everywhere.
The wall back last September
when
they announced it, and or two Septembers ago now. And that's absolutely true. And I think it's still finding its way. I think you're right. It's telling that, for me, the most compelling uses of it are the face itself and the notifications I get and Siri. Not the apps and the glances.
I just wish the just face were on enough. All the time, don't you?
It would be nice.
Really annoying.
I've completely internalized that little wrist flip, but I'd rather I didn't have to do it. Sure.
No, I think, that if the face was on all the time, it would make life much easier. Yeah. And also, if you could enable the payment function without having to have the security code on it, because I hate that darn security code. Like, that is just the stupidest thing in the world. But if you have a credit card synchronized to it, you have to have it. And it's like... Those are the two things that drive me absolutely nuts.
Well, one thing that drives me nuts with Apple is their passion for security means they ask for passwords and codes far too often.
Oh,
all the time.
Endlessly. Yeah.
And
type in your App Store password. Type in your
And this is with fingerprint. I mean, this is you know, it's like, but I gave you my fingerprint. What more do you want? Mm-hmm. Not like I have Katie Benner's phone or something. This is my phone.
I think that it's going to be interesting to see how this plays out. I'm not like a big watch advocate because I don't use mine as much as a lot of people I know, but it kind of reminds me of very early days of the PC where people would get these boxes to their houses and be like, what the hell do I do with this
enthusiast.
Thing? Like, it wasn't until desktop publishing, I think, that people were like, oh, now I understand there's a real use case for this enormous... ugly machine I keep lying around the house that all I've done is play games on. So I think that the watch, if it works out, is going to be similar. It could be a while before we're like, oh, of course, we're all going to pay for things with this watch. Like, that's the best thing we can do with it.
I think you nailed it. I think we're in the watch is in the checkbook balancing phase. Mm. You know, when you first got a PC, all you really could... I'll balance my checkbook again and again because it didn't do anything. and so this is a product full of potential waiting. So I'm open-minded about that, but I just feel as of today, it's not a particularly compelling product. For those of us who have it, you know, we already paid for it. So you know what? We gave one to our 13-year-old for his birthday a week ago. He wears it every day, loves it. But it's kind of isn't it kind of a status symbol a little bit too? Like, you know.
That's part of the game, I think.
I think that's
like
part of
the
game.
iPod was back then.
That's kind of true for every watch, right? I mean, whether, you know, we often think about
that's
like,
true.
the Apple Watch as being like this unique sort of thing. And it's like, no, a watch is a status symbol. Whoever wears it, right? You could either wear a Rolex or a Tag or an Apple, right?
Or Timex.
When I was 13, I had a Casio calculator watch, and that sent a strong message.
No dates for the next several years, exactly, I believe, was the message it sent.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. I want that watch now. Do you still have it? Would you?
No, it's long gone, and sure I wish.
Oh. That's the one that had a stylus, right? Because the
No. This was just a little tiny buttons that were very hard to press, though. That's true.
Because there was a Casio or somebody that made a calculator watch that you had to have a stylus because the buttons were so small. Hey, look, $15.99 on eBay.
That's a more recent model.
And you know what? No activation lock on this one, I'm pretty sure.
They make one in gold as well. Casio makes one in gold.
Really? Which one is yours? Is it this one?
It's just, this is all nostalgia purposes now.
That's $50, but you know, I'd wear that with pride.
It can't look metallic. It's got to be just black plastic.
Black plastic? Which one did you have?
I don't know. It was one of the old models. I think it had the buttons were silver, and it was a black face, and it was a
very sexy.
It was super nerdy.
Love that. See that on a girl's back at a dance? You know, you're a man. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, be sure to wear that status symbol. I'm just saying, status symbol.
All right, Gruber. Gruber's been straying off the reservation a lot lately. He talks about the fact that Sketch, which is an app, actually an app that's been in the conversation a lot because Bohemian Coding, the folks who did it, said that they were not going to do an iPad Pro version of an app that would be great on the iPad Pro because they didn't feel like they could sell a $99 app on an iPad without a demo version or something, you know. Apple wasn't really helping them. Now they pull it from the Mac App Store because of a bunch of gripes about, you know, I mean, there's issues about updating. There was a certificate expiration problem that was a real issue with Apple. They let their certificate expire, and a lot of apps said, hey, you know, I can't run anymore. So he says there's a lot of reasons why we're taking Sketch from the Mac App Store. App review takes at least a week. There are technical limitations imposed by the guidelines, sandboxing, and so on. Upgrade pricing unavailable. That's a big issue for expensive apps. If you buy Adobe Photoshop, you don't want to pay a full price for an upgrade. And Adobe does want to make some money on the upgrade. In any event.
Yeah, this is a problem. That's a problem with the iOS App Store too. The differences are that Mac apps tend to be more professional and they tend to have bigger prices. And what that leads to is issues about, you know, how do I charge for upgrades? Well, you can't. How do I give people a trial? Well, you can't. So you could restructure your app to be sort of freemium with an in-app purchase of some features.
People often say that when I say, oh, you know, Sketch wanted the ability to have a demo version. Why can't we do freemium? Isn't that an okay way to do it?
Well, you can build it that way, but you've got to build it into your app, and you've got to architect your app to have features that are behind an in-app purchase, and it gets complicated. And on the Mac, you can just bail out. I mean, that's the bottom line, is the Mac App Store was seen as a place you wanted to be despite all of these limitations, plus the technical, like the sandboxing and security limitations. And you would go through them because you needed to be there, because it was going to be a rocket that you could strap yourself to, and it would drive your app into the stratosphere, and it would sell just like iOS apps sold, and you'll be a millionaire. And the fact is, Mac App Store, I mean, all the anecdotes are people who rank in the top 10 with their app and then report that they didn't really make very much on it. It looks like there's not a lot going on in most parts of the Mac App Store. Mm-hmm. And so at that point, why would you put in the money and time to build the Mac App Store version of your app when it's easier to just sell it yourself?
But the good news is you can do both. It's not like
unlike
we have
on iOS.
To. Right. iOS, you're stuck. Gruber writes, the Mac App Store should be designed to make developers happy. It should make developing for the Mac better, not worse than selling outside the App Store. These are among the best apps on the platform from developers who've been loyal to Apple and the Mac for decades. He's talking about Bare Bones, BB Edit, Panix, Coda, Quicken. The Mac App Store is rotting, at least for productivity software. There's no other way to put it. If this hasn't set off alarm bells within Apple, something's very wrong. We've talked about this a lot on Mac Break Weekly. There needs to be an App Store czar.
Yeah, he's absolutely right. It feels like there's nobody paying attention to it. It seems to have not been updated in ages. The approval process is really delayed. And, it just doesn't seem like it's a priority for Apple. So why would you stay in it if you could avoid
it? This is one thing that drives me crazy about Apple. Google's prone to this, too. which is it feels like the Eye of Mordor. They can only point one way at a time. Right? And if they're looking here, they're not looking there. The remote app still hasn't been updated to work with the new Apple TV.
Yep.
They didn't update it for 3 years, and then they've again ignored it. And it turned out there was one guy. Apple's a big company. It's the most valuable company in the world. It's got huge amounts of cash. $120 billion in the bank. Can't they have two eyes?
I'm curious, is there the equivalent of a Guy Kawasaki working there right now, or somebody whose only job is to sort of cultivate this community of developers, help them, work with them, make their lives easier, or did that just disappear altogether at
some point?
There's
a whole developer relations team. I think the problem is, the impression I get is that the people who run the App Store are not the developer relations team.
They're not related.
They're the iTunes team.
Yeah.
And this is one of those things where...
And let's not even get started on iTunes, right?
I mean, yeah.
Come on. Mm-hmm. Talk about, can you only point, like, can you only have an eye in one direction? Can we please fix the one thing that everybody in the world uses to get all their media and make it not a complete horror show?
Yeah,
there was a guy, Michael Jurowitz, who was their evangelist.
Jury's still there.
I thought he left to go to Black Pixel.
He did, and he came back.
Oh, he came back.
Yeah, I think Jury's still at.
All right, so he's kind of the guy, right?
Well, he's one in one area. He's working on OS X, I think. But
okay.
I forget where Jury is now. But yeah, there are developers and developer relations people, and they talk all the time. But the services in the back end and who's doing the promotions and doing the app approvals, my understanding is that that's a different group. And they seem to be more focused on, I don't know what, building Apple Music.
According to Simply Hired, 32 openings for developer evangelists at Apple right now.
Apple is famously understaffed, right? They're very slow to hire. They're very slow to hire.
And they may, they have valuable stock.
I think we should all apply. There are 32 jobs.
I could do it.
I think we should.
Please, Jason, write your app for Apple. Please, please, write.
Let go me. Write it okay, for fine. I give up. Fine.
I can do that. All right. Enough Apple. We've done our Apple segment. Whew. Let's talk about Barbie in a moment. Hello, Barbie. The NSA is listening.
Math class is hard.
Actually, this talking Barbie, this Hello Barbie is so cool. And I know the people behind the engine, but there's an issue. Mm-hmm. Of course, there's always an issue. Great panel today. Katie Benner, thank you for being here from the New York Times via San Francisco. So you're in the San Francisco Bureau.
Mm-hmm.
Great people in that Bureau.
Yeah.
Markov's there, right?
Yes, and he is awesome.
Love John Markov. Say hi to him. Tell him to be on our show once in a while.
I will.
I love John Markov.
Leo Laporte.
Yeah, he knows me. We've been on many times. He evangelizes. I love. There's so many good people in that San Francisco bureau. So, and pretty much focusing on Silicon Valley, I would guess, right?
That is correct.
Yeah, you guys do a great job. There's three news apps on all my devices. Washington Post, because Bezos gives it to me for cheap. Mm. he bought his way onto my phone. The New York Times app, that's the one I read all the time. And Nuzzle, which I'm a big fan of. Isn't Nuzzle great?
Nuzzle's the best.
Nuzzle is, for those who don't know, first of all, download it and try it. It's Jonathan Abrams, the guy who did Friendster. It's his app, and it's a social app. It collates social signals from your Twitter and Facebook feeds and then tells you what your friends are talking about. What also friends of friends... And then stories you might have missed. And I just find that a really great resource. Will Harris is also here. He is the director of digital at Condé Nast UK. Head of digital. He's a digital head.
Hopefully the rest of me is digital too, but I'll take just the head
What does that mean? Is that like a strategy guy?
Yeah, so each of the titles that we publish, so like Wired and Vogue and GQ, like has digital people that sort of run those titles. But I have a team of people that kind of work across all the titles doing strategy and product development and those kind of things.
That sounds like a really fun job.
I once gave a presentation on matrix management. That's how fun a job it is.
Okay, never mind. I'm sorry I said anything.
Take
that?
It all back.
God. I forgot how much I hate corporate life. You know who's a refugee from corporate life? Jason Snell. He left behind those IDG folks. He now has his own thing. And, you know, it's great.
Thank you.
Sixcolors.com. You do a great job covering mostly Apple.
Yeah, it's mostly Apple. Some other tech stuff, too.
And then The Incomparable, which is a collection of great podcasts, including...
I've lost track. There's so many podcasts
yeah,
now.
Yeah, we really have grown a lot. Holy cow. I am on the Incomparable Radio Theater from a couple of episodes ago, right?
Yeah, you're in... which one were you in? You were the announcer in the Sky Mounties, which was pretty early in the season.
I was in Sky Mounties.
And then in January, you'll be back.
It's not on yet.
It's not on, that new one. You play a mad scientist in something called Full Fathom 5. That'll be out in January.
Full Fathom 5.
That's right. You and Andy Iannotko are sort of dueling mad
Andy's
scientists.
Andy's wild.
Yeah.
Andy does a Jacques Cousteau accent that is very bizarre. Mm-hmm. That's all I can say. Mm-hmm. But that was fun because you get everybody, all the cast together on Skype, and we record our parts, but we record them locally for quality, but we're all in real time, kind of, so that's fun.
Yeah, it was a
please invite me back.
Absolutely.
I'll try better next time.
No, you did great. I loved your mad scientist.
Oh, you said you wanted, I didn't know.
There's a monster, and you did the monster voice, too, which we weren't even asking you to do, and you just jumped right in and did the monster voice.
I hope this isn't a spoiler, but the monster eats me.
Yeah,
and then it says in the script, the monster sounds like all the people it's eaten.
Yes.
Mixed together. Mm-hmm. So I tried to, you know.
You did it. You jumped right in there. You did a great job. When you sent me the file, I got to listen to you personally going, like a monster. It's awesome.
A lot of fun. I'm sorry. Anyway, more to come on This Week in Tech. Great. I'm sorry. I'm getting a little mushy because it's that time of year. You know, it's the holidays and everything. I just love doing this show because I get to just be with my friends, people I love the most. I'm sorry I didn't bake a turkey or something for you guys. Our show today. Hello. How are you? Good to see you. People are, we rolled up the curtains because it's a rainy day in Petaluma. So people could see in the window. And they're baffled. This is a small town and it looks like we're doing a TV show in here. And they're very, there's like, what is going on?
Yeah, she waved at us though. That's nice.
She waved. That was nice. Usually they have other gestures.
Given us the finger. Yeah, but she didn't.
Our show today brought to you by stamps.com. You know, we're going to do, I don't know if we've done it yet, we're going to do some B-roll where you have a video of people using stamps.com. And they said, Leo, would you do this? I said, but you know what? I don't use stamps.com. Our office staff uses stamps.com. Shoot them doing it. Stamps.com, but they're huge fans. I was a fan when I still had to do my own mailing. Stamps.com means you don't have to go to the post office anymore. If you use the postal service for mailing, if you're an eBay or an Amazon seller, Stamps.com will give you that professional look. You print the postage. You could print it, of course, for a package, but you can also print right on an envelope, any kind of mail. Media mail, if you're sending out books, and you look so pro. Your logo shows up if you want. It automatically takes the address from the addressee, from the web page, so there are fewer mistakes. Your return address is auto-filled in there. It even fills out forms like certified mail, return receipt, even international customs forms. Automatically. So it really is pro. If you're sending by certified mail or return receipt, it'll send out an email to your recipient saying, here it comes, here's the tracking number. You can get discounts you can't get at the post office. You never have to go to the post office. You don't even need special ink or a postage meter. It does it all with a computer. You have the printer you have, and they'll come and get the mail. There's this thing called a mail carrier, a person who comes to your door, takes the mail from you, and brings it to the post office. What will they think of next? It's amazing. I love stamps.com, and we're going to wait for you to try this. It's a great deal, $110 bonus offer. But we're also going to give you the digital scale, because that's really helpful, because then you have exactly the right postage all the time. You just plop the thing on the scale, and it's USB, so it goes right into the computer and tells the software exactly how much it weighs. You also get, and this is really sweet, $55 worth of free postage you can use over the first few months of your account. Stamps.com. A four-week trial, the digital scale. You get an activities, a supplies kit. You get a whole bunch of stuff. And all you have to do is click the microphone in the upper right-hand corner and enter the offer code TWIT. T-W-I-T. This is a very good deal. And this is the time of year. You don't want to be going to the post office this time of year. There's traffic. There's parking. Everybody's mailing their holiday gifts. Aunt Bertha goes to the post office once a year and buys one stamp at a time. You don't want to be behind her. So use stamps.com. You can. It's what the pros use. Stamps.com. So you do a different, like, are you doing different stories on
Incomparable Radio? Yeah, it's like an anthology. There's some characters that recur. And then there are others that
Serenity directs.
So Serenity directs, and David Lohr is our playwright.
He's good.
He is very
He's
good.
Very funny.
Yeah, yeah. And so we do different styles. So Full Fathom 5 is about a team of people in a submarine who solve... It's like Voyage to the Bottom of the
but
Sea,
but it's like
basically.
Old-time radio.
Yeah, exactly right. So yeah. They're a full cast and music, and Chris Breen, actually, who used to be...
Great music.
He does the music for it, who used to be a Macworld. And, yeah, there's a Doctor Who parody, and you did the Sky Mounties, which is like a Canadian... police who fly a plane, and there's all sorts of stuff.
It's fun. Here's the live performance you guys did some time ago in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Hey, speaking of Doctor Who, isn't the last episode, is it tonight? When
it was
is it?
Last night.
Last night? Was it good?
It was really good, yeah.
Is Capaldi a good Doctor Who?
He's so good.
I love him.
He's so good.
He doesn't, you know, the only thing I know him from is In the Loop, and that British political comedy.
The Thick of It. So good.
Which is awesome, but he has a foul mouth.
He is, yes.
And I thought, is this the Doctor Who?
He just doesn't swear.
I really
swear.
Hope that none of the kids who are watching Doctor Who go and Google Peter Capaldi and be like, ooh, what else has the Doctor been in?
Oh, does he have a foul mouth?
Yeah.
But in a very funny way.
A lot of it has become sort of totally iconic now. You sort of see sort of British people sort of say that stuff in the office all the time because it's just such a...
Oh, good.
I mean, possibly not ideal, but you know.
I only saw In the Loop. He's in that, right? That's the movie version.
Yep.
And then the TV show that preceded the movie was The Thick of It?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can see it here or not.
It's on Hulu.
It is on Hulu. Yep. Okay, good.
Oh, my word. Go and start at the beginning and watch it all. It is all brilliant.
It really is.
Is it? And he plays a cabinet minister? No, a press secretary.
Spin doctor.
Spin yeah. doctor.
Yeah.
So there's not from the spin doctor to the Doctor Who.
Yeah, not very loosely based on a guy called Alistair Campbell, who was Tony Blair's spin doctor for many years and was famously angry.
He's very, very angry. But I'm told the chat room saying the last two episodes, the closing two episodes, I'm going to confess something that's shameful. I'm really not a Doctor Who fan.
Well, that's okay. There's some of you out there. But the episode before last was it's essentially just Peter Capaldi.
Oh, nice.
He has 99% of the spoken lines in the episode. It's basically a one-man show. Very good.
Oh, wow.
Very good.
Back me on this, though, Will Harris. Wasn't it intended to be a children's show?
Doctor Who kind of originally was always that kind of slightly kind of like early evening, it's a children's show, but with kind of like themes for adults. And I think it broadly kind of has the same kind of approach now. It's definitely kid appropriate, if okay. not kid friendly, I would say.
Unlike
and then
the
that
thick
said,
of it.
Leo, I'm gonna say something now. I have never seen an episode of Doctor Who in my life.
You have to hand in your passport now. I'm sorry.
Okay, so Will, I've seen one.
Oh, you're beating me there.
It was
you're
so god awful that I said I'm never watching this again.
Yeah.
It was something about Daleks in a warehouse. There were mannequins involved.
Interesting. Terror of the mannequins.
It was the terror of the mannequins, probably something like that. I don't know. It was somebody told me, don't start at the beginning because it really is cheesy in the beginning. So I
started. There's so many beginnings now.
Well, I know, and he said, "This is the Doctor Who you want to see," and I watched an episode, and I thought, "Okay, not for me.
It might not be.
I have to hand in my geek card now." We are excited about Star Wars. Does it open in the UK on the 18th?
It opens, the 18th. So midnight on the 17th. So just the 18th.
We're gonna be going. We got 22 tickets.
I think we get it a day before you guys.
Oh, you bastards!
Yeah, it's amazing. And France gets it the day before us. I was sort of contemplating going to France to go and watch it.
That's why God made the channel, so you could get right over there and watch the movie.
You could get over there.
But it'd be in French,
I'm worried I'll turn up and they'll have like French subtitles or something, and I just hate it. So I'm like, so I've got a 5 a.m. showing on Thursday to go and see it.
Wow.
On IMAX, I can't wait.
Ah, that's the question. How should one see it? In 3D? In IMAX?
Well, I'd rather not see it in 3D because I don't really like 3D.
Yeah, I don't either.
But pretty much all the good theaters in London are showing it in 3D. So if you want to go to like a really crummy theater, you can watch it in 2D. But if you want a good theater, you got to watch it in 3D.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Yeah.
Jason, what are you doing?
On the Thursday night, so it opens on a week from Thursday, right?
Yeah.
And I've got tickets. Yeah. And down the road here in where I live in Marin County, we have still have that one big single screen movie theater that's showing it. I think it's alternating 2D and 3D. We may be seeing a 3D showing, which is not my favorite, but it's a nice, huge, single-screen movie theater. So, as it was meant to be seen, I think.
I don't think you should go to France to see it, because I can't see Darth Vader. I've translated Darth Vader into French.
Je trouve votre manque de foi dérangé.
That doesn't have that.
How about, non,
non.
Je suis votre père. Non.
Not the same. Hello, Hackable Barbie. There's a new Barbie that it's actually pretty cool. It comes from a company. Well, it comes from Mattel, who makes Barbie. But they enlisted a company called Toy Talk. We've interviewed the people at Toy Talk. They're really, really cool. They make a variety of toys, iPad apps and so forth, that children are encouraged to talk to. And it doesn't just stay with Barbie. It goes up to a server where it's analyzed, and then Barbie is told what to say in response. Apparently, there's a little problem with Hello Barbie. Now, it's not out yet, so there's time to fix this. The Hello Barbie, Blue Box Security analyzed it, and there's apparently some issues with an internet-connected doll. Vulnerabilities in the mobile app and cloud storage used by the doll. I never thought I'd be saying that on Twit. Vulnerabilities in the mobile app and cloud storage used by the doll could have allowed hackers to eavesdrop on children's intimate play sessions. So they're going to fix it. Toy Talk says, all right, they've showed us. We've fixed many of the issues they've raised. The researchers say they told Toy Talk about this weeks ago. The company has been very responsive. Good news. But that's a concern. You know, a number of people have been kind of concerned in general about the privacy impact of Hello Barbie. The way it works, the child has the Barbie, presses a button on its stomach and talks to it. And it's sent then to the internet, where a server processes it and the doll responds with one of thousands of pre-recorded messages. So people are, understanding that that's a little... In fact, there was a petition that said that that's creepy. I don't know. You find that creepy?
It's like Siri, basically.
It's Siri.
Inside a toy.
It's preparing a child for Siri.
That's right. My first intelligent assistant.
Yes. The Toy Talk app actually is kind of cool. Let me see if they have it, because they have on their website some samples of this technology. They have a Thomas the Tank Engine that talks to you, this Hello Barbie. And then we interviewed them when they were doing the apps, like Speak a Legend, The Winston Show, Speak a Zoo. And they said there was actually some psychological value to this. So these are actual audio recordings of children. The parents submitted them and signed off. And so if you listen to this, this is one of the characters in the iPad app poses a question to the child.
She is saying that you cannot just fall in love, but that you can also fall out of love, like it is a nest or the mouth of a younger predator.
6, 7, 8 years old.
She says that I am having to think of ways to keep our love from falling out of her heart, or her heart from falling out of... It's all very confusing, Zookeeper. Please, tell me what I must do so that nobody falls out of love.
So now the child is in a private session in the room talking to this thing.
Well, you must be very kind to her and bring her gifts now and then and remember her important dates. Like if you were to get married, anniversaries or birthdays.
So they're trying to create a dialogue, almost a psychotherapeutic dialogue with the child that gets them to start thinking about these bigger questions, and they say it's really valuable. It's very, it's really interesting. Do you find that creepy?
It's like a Ray Bradbury story.
Yeah,
they're like the Velt or something, right? Go ahead, Kitty.
Oh no, I mean, kids. This is how kids play, and it is helpful and beneficial for development. But we're usually not eavesdropping on them when they do it. You know what I mean? So when a child's playing with his or her favorite teddy bear, it's often these sort of questions going back and forth, like, discussions and dialogue, but we don't observe it.
Yeah, we've all seen kids do that when they're playing with their toys. That's what they do, right? They have these elaborate conversations.
Yeah, so I mean, it did creep me out somewhat to hear the demo.
Is it a little creepy?
I don't think I should be listening to this, but it's inevitable though that adults and children are going to just get used to this idea that our queries and the things that we say are being constantly recorded by something in our house that we've invited in and want to have around, like Alexa, for example,
or the NSA.
Or the NSA. Well, I guess it depends on whether or not you use Apple or Android. No, just kidding. Just kidding. joke.
I think that it's fair to say that we don't know who's the NSA's co-opted, and whether it's Android or Apple, it could be either or both. Here's the hello Barbie. I think this is for older kids, though, right?
Oh,
that's a little
Barbie,
weird.
No,
we have to plug her butt in.
Download the Hello Barbie app, launch the app, and tap the Get Started button.
I really do think this is preparing kids for a new digital future, Katie. I think you're exactly
enter
right.
Your email address and
oh my God!
An email will be sent to you.
You can't play with your doll until you enter your email address.
Hello Barbie.
Install the app.
Go to your settings.
Jesus, hello, Barbie, complicated.
Does Barbie have Touch ID? Did I just see that?
Parent will presume. The Barbie has her own Wi-Fi. Oh, by the way, that was one of the security flaws, is it joins the Barbie Wi-Fi. They're all named Barbie something. It would be trivial for a bad guy to set up a Wi-Fi access point, Barbie.hacker, and the kid could very easily accidentally choose the wrong and start sending. I don't know if that's really a big problem or not.
I think the more times you've got microphones connected to the internet in your home, the more you need to be aware of this,
we have,
right?
Amazon Echo in every room now. I want everything to listen. Don't, or maybe I'm. I am on the radio.
It's awfully convenient. You're used to broadcasting your voice.
Everybody hears everything I say all the time. I don't.
Play games. What do you want to be when you grow up?
I want to be a vet.
That's wonderful. Wanting to take care of sick animals is an amazing
See,
role.
That's pretty cool.
Hello, yeah. Barbie can tell stories.
Because Barbie knows, oh, vet, I know what that is. Playtime on the battery. It's like a modern Eliza. Remember the the bot that would make sure you turn off your Barbie when you're done and put her back on her dock.
It's still a Barbie, and that's the thing. Like, this is not a natural-looking doll. I mean, this is not past the Turing test at all. This is so creepy to watch these children talk to this doll.
But kids, also, did you have Barbies as a kid, Katie? Right?
Well, I mean, yeah, and of course, like, when I was growing up, we had the teddy bear that spoke.
Teddy Ruxpin.
Teddy Ruxpin. It was the same. It was the same exact thing, except it wasn't recording us. But it was the same idea where you have this inanimate object that makes you feel like your friends. So, I mean, that part, I get, and I think is fine. Yeah, it's just security flaws should probably be thought of before people make these things. This is always the problem, right? It's not whether or not they're creepy at the end of the day, because this is sort of what life is becoming. We don't love it, but it is happening. It's that the people who are making the speakers or the dolls or the teddy bears might think of security as an afterthought, in part because they're like, well, what the hell would somebody do with like 24 hours of audio of some random kid talking to a doll, you know, like what do you even do with those conversations? But it's still sort of like the idea that people and manufacturers are irresponsible and don't care that I think is probably more disturbing.
Somebody said this is the new data mining Barbie. I like it. Data mining Barbie. Part of the reason their sensitivity, of course, is because of the VTech breach. VTech makes children's toys. They're a Chinese company, and they announced a couple of weeks ago that 5 million customer accounts had been hacked and harvested by the bad guys, including the user profiles of the kids connected to those accounts, email addresses, names, encrypted passwords, security questions and answers, IP addresses, mailing addresses, the download history, no credit card numbers, no social security numbers. You know, so there's 190 gigabytes of kids' photos and chats stored on VTech servers. That's a little bit more an issue on the same at the same time. What are you going to do with that, right? I mean, I guess if you were, you know, a pederast, that would be.
Well, it's important. I think it's important that we don't live in a world where there's a product or a service that's connected on the internet that doesn't need security,
right?
And it seems like the VTech policies were not really considering the fact that they needed to take it seriously.
They've been doing digital stuff for kids for a long time.
Right?
Say again?
I was going to say they seemed pretty woefully inadequate, like things being stored in plain text and sent in the clear, and it's like it's just not even close to good security practice.
So from now, you're muted again, I think, Will. So from now on, I think it's very nice face, though. It's very expressive. Will doesn't need speech. He could just make faces. Are you there now?
Yeah, it just seemed like, is that working now?
Yeah. And somebody's pointing out it's not just the kids talking to the dolls. You also have any background audio going on, mom and dad fighting, shouting their social security numbers at the top of their lungs. Yeah.
As you do.
As one does, yeah. No, but I think that's exactly right. This is early days. Now's a very good time to start paying attention to this. These breaches are a good reminder that everything is now going to be connected to the internet. Maybe it's time to pay attention to this stuff. We had yesterday on the new screensavers, we had the new Raspberry Pi. $5 computer, so cheap they're putting it in the Magpie magazine for free. You buy the magazine, get a computer. Buy the magazine, get a computer. A $5 computer with an HDMI port, a USB port, storage on an SD card. I mean, this is amazing. And, of course, those can be put in all sorts of devices. I mean, the internet is, you know, and computers are going to be in everything because they're so cheap. No reason not to. Computerize it. Why not? Mark Zuckerberg had a baby. Priscilla Chan, his wife, posted on Facebook. Lovely picture of the two of them. It's actually a very sweet picture. Do you have kids? Will, you don't have kids.
Oh, hell no. I would be a disaster. Katie, I can barely look after myself.
I know. Katie, you don't have kids, right?
No.
So do you two, Jason, you don't.
I do.
You do. So we're fathers, but when you two are not parents, when you look at this, does this make you want to have children?
No.
This isn't like, to me, I look at this and I go, oh, isn't that sweet? Those first moments you have with your newborn baby. Just so sweet.
Makes me want to set up a limited liability corporation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Immediately.
I think I'd have children with Zuckerberg if I got some of the $450 billion, whatever it is.
$45 billion. Come on now.
Yeah.
Let's be real. So there has been a surprising amount of snark about this, by the way. So Mark wrote a long letter to our daughter, published Tuesday with the announcement of Max. Her name is Max. Max's birth. And kind of buried the lead because in the final paragraphs he mentions, oh, and by the way, we're going to give away 99% of our Facebook shares, currently worth $45 billion, during our lives to advance personalized learning, curing disease, connecting people, building strong communities. Wonderful. They created the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, and they formed, now, and this is where the snark began, an LLC, not a charitable foundation, as most would, but an LLC. And I think it's a little bit of an unfair bit of snarking going on. I think it's genuine that they plan to give away currently $45 billion. It's probably going to be a lot more, 99% of their fortune. That's what Bill Gates is doing, Warren Buffett is doing. How do you all feel about the notion that because it's an LLC, they can, for instance, channel tax away, they can make profit?
Any charitable donation is tax deductible. I mean, we
right.
So we do that because we want people to give to charity. There's a reason why that exists. So I don't think that should be criticized. And the LLC structure it gives them a little bit more optionality in terms of what they give their money to. You know, so they can give the money to
they can even invest
organizations.
It. Yeah,
they can also invest it in the same way that, like, I don't know, Harvard Management Company invests the endowment so that they
exactly.
can always have a lot of money to give to Harvard. You know what I mean?
Instead even increase that amount of money, right?
And increase the amount depending on how well the investment goes. So I don't think this is bad. I just, I was surprised by a lot of the criticism as well. But I think that part of it is because Silicon Valley does seem really cut off from the rest of the country. The amounts of money that are sort of made here seem really unreal to most of the U.S., frankly, you know, this is a very, very different place. And the amount of wealth that's here is very different from your average town in the Midwest or New England or pretty much anywhere else in the country. Yeah. So there's a natural suspicion, I think, of things that happen here because they seem so divorced from the reality of what other people face day to day.
And it, absolutely. And it's even worse when it comes to Mark Zuckerberg. I think there's a lot of kind of mistrust of what Mark's up to.
Well, because there was a lot of mistrust around Facebook in the early days of the company. I mean, some of that's gone away. But if you think about it, there was like not 6 months that could go by without Facebook doing something that made everybody really upset about privacy and be like, oh, what are you doing? So, I mean, there's some blowback there, but I don't think that essentially what they've done is bad. I think it's kind of great. I mean, it's like a lot of money to put to use other than just making other people rich.
Yeah,
you know,
right on. Felix Salmon, who's a well-known financial reporter, has a nice British accent, so I trust him. Wrote a very, I thought a very, I think, you know, and Jeff Jarvis posted this and I noticed it, and he wrote kind of the, flattened this story on Fusion. He says, Mark Zuckerberg wants to change the world. Again, you got a problem with that? And really explains why the LLC, why this is not a bad thing, and praises him, as I think we probably should, for doing this. There is often the question, though, hey, these guys have so much money. That $45 billion is so much money. It could really – do we want people like Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg, Warren Buffett kind of unilaterally determining the future of the world? But better that, as you say, Katie, better than that than, you know, building a mansion.
Right, and also, like, the politicians who are supposed to be doing that aren't really stepping up right now, so they've left kind of a vacuum. So if it, you know what I mean? It's, if we had a really robust political system with politicians who were thoughtful and trying in earnest to solve problems, not just preserve their jobs, I don't think there'd be as much of a huge hole for wealthy people to fill.
And this isn't new. I mean, the rail barons created charitable foundations for a lot of their wealth.
Carnegie. We have a Carnegie Library in town.
Exactly.
Andrew Carnegie, the steel baron. Although he was a son of a bitch, late in his life decided maybe I want to go to heaven after all.
Yeah.
And gave libraries. We have a beautiful Carnegie Free Library in Petaluma.
Yeah, and there are lots of things like that that have happened. So I think the judgment's going to take probably longer than we're alive about how well this money gets spent. But, you know, this is, it's not bad to have this, I think, in general. It just depends on what they do with it. The Gates Foundation has done some amazing work in some places, and I think arguably, you know, some of their other work has been less successful, but that happens in lots of endeavors.
Jesse Eisinger, among others, criticizing it, saying this should be the occasion to mull what kind of society we want to live in and who should fund our general society needs and how charities rarely fill quotidian yet vital needs. What would $40 billion mean for job creation or infrastructure spending? And I think you're right, Katie. If our government were doing a better job on those things, these questions wouldn't be raised. But, you know, one of the things Zuckerberg says he's going to work on climate change. I think in the light of the Paris climate talks, this is absolutely an appropriate thing for all of them to work on. I think this is great. I think if you read up on it and understand what he's doing, it's nothing but good here. But I did want to raise the issue in case of anybody wanted to explain why it wasn't such a good thing. It's tough to do. I mean, Bill Gates always said, I'm not going to become a philanthropist until I have the time to decide what's the right way to spend the money. He advanced that timeline a little bit. I think initially said, I'm not going to do it till after I leave Microsoft because I'm too busy running this company. But when he got married, Melinda, I think, advanced the foundation and started running some of the foundation's giving efforts before Gates left. And now that, of course, that he's no longer at Microsoft, I think it's a full-time job.
And isn't it great if you took, you know, the combined wealth of the Forbes 100 or whatever and said to them, right, you know, you guys all give away 99% of your wealth into something. Like, look at the effect that Bill Gates has been able to have on malaria, right? He's almost single-handedly, like, getting rid of that globally. Imagine what you could do if everybody in that Forbes 100 did that, right? How can you possibly argue that's going to be a miserable thing?
Salmon quotes John Arnold, another billionaire philanthropist, who says, quote, I believe much of the highest value add in philanthropy is in things that are controversial. that they are controversial is exactly why there is underinvestment and thus the most to gain in these areas. That actually makes a lot of sense. He says, I think many philanthropically inclined people struggle with how to give away very large sums. The institutions most adept at handling large grants are universities, hospitals, cultural institutions. But maybe better to find some niches that, need some funding besides those.
Right, like Mike Bloomberg has done. I mean, he's made a name for himself only giving away tons of money to really controversial things. He's very pro-gun control. He has really strong views on healthcare and on the way that people eat, as any New York City resident can tell you, when he wanted to get rid of our
he
soda.
He banned supersized sodas, yeah.
He tried.
Tried. They're back?
I believe so, yeah. We can drink as much horrible stuff as we want. But I mean, that's the thing. He's not afraid to wade into controversy. And he's kind of like, well, if I have the money and I have the influence and the clout, why not use it for something real rather than give more to, like, you know, another museum? He gives a lot to museums, don't get me wrong. But he's also not afraid to put his name on stuff that a lot of people would rather back away from. John Arnold is the same. He wanted to, and he did fund a huge initiative around tax reform. I mean, that's pretty controversial. People don't want to see that happen.
Right. Isn't Michael Bloomberg being bandied about as the next mayor of London? Have you heard that, Will? I didn't make that up. Maybe I had a fever dream and I... No? Are you sure?
Yeah, pretty sure. The last I heard, he was going back to actually doing some work running Bloomberg, right? He was sort of stepping back into doing a bit more there. No, we have a very interesting London mayor race, Boris. But I don't think he's in it.
Boris, but when Boris leaves...
My understanding is that he is back and engaged at Bloomberg, his company, that he's back and he's happy to be back in charge of it.
Well, in fact, here's a direct quote in the Telegraph, Michael Bloomberg, zero chance I'll run for mayor of London. So, and there's a picture of him next to Boris.
Yeah, but that's great that newspaper got, at least two stories out of that. The story saying that he might, the might story run. That he wouldn't.
Yeah. He says he has zero interest. Actually, he told the Times this. Zero interest. So I'm not, it wasn't a fever dream. There was briefly, he said that at one point he said that my 12 years as mayor of New York City was a suitable apprenticeship for running London.
It was a rumor started by Bloomberg employees.
Yeah, probably. Get him out of here.
Building.
He was knighted. He is Sir Michael. No, actually, he's not allowed to be Sir Michael, right? If you're not a British citizen.
He can't be Sir Knighted. So he can be knighted, but he can't be Sir Michael.
He can't be Sir Michael. So, do we like Boris Johnson, Will?
Oh my God, I am not getting into that conversation. That is going to be an absolute...
Is he a Peter Capaldi type? Can you imagine him swearing a blue streak in...
He's done a few good things.
Okay. I was just talking about the London Eye and how much... At first, I thought, what a bad idea to have one of the most beautiful skylines in the world dominated by a Ferris wheel. But then I wrote it, and I thought, well, this is pretty cool.
It's a pretty cool Ferris wheel, to be fair. There are worse buildings in London, I can tell you that for sure.
Are you not a fan of the Gherkin?
The Gherkin, the walkie-talkie is the latest controversial one. The walkie-talkie's been a problem because whoever designed it didn't quite realize that the angle at which they built the glass would reflect the sun down in the summer onto the pavement.
Oh, Lord.
And they had to change the glass in some of the upper areas because it was like melting, burning things on the ground. The classical thing of taking an egg and, baking it on the pavement. You do it in 30 seconds,
It looks like, it does look kind of like a giant walkie-talkie.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's pretty dire.
That is one ugly ass building, actually. Better than the buildings in front of it, the 60s era buildings in front of it. But
Strike It Rich in the chat room says that Rob Ford is the next person to run for London.
There you go, the vaunted mayor of Toronto. Is Ford still the mayor? No.
Isn't he dead?
Let's start a rumor. You know who's not dead yet? Marissa Meyer. We're still waiting.
Oh my God, that's the most awkward.
All right. I apologize.
Terrible leader.
I'm not dead yet. I'll take a break. We'll talk about Yahoo. Because the board met right this week, but we haven't heard anything. There was all sorts of wild talk about selling off the assets, maybe firing their CEO. A lot of talk about her severance package. Nice severance package. Not $45 billion, but a good amount of money. Our show today brought to you by Harry's. I feel like this should be a British company. Harry's. For guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction,
of the price.
Yes. Harry's is, they actually, they bought the company in Germany that makes the blades. There's only a handful of really great razor blade companies and manufacturers, and they bought it so they can make better razors at half the price of the drugstore blades. And but now I want to mention this as a great gift idea. I know I by now most of you are shaving with Harry's, and if you haven't yet, go there right now. Take a look at the Harry's kits. Fantastic price. You start as low as $15, and you get. But this would be a great gift too. If you've got a secret Santa at your office, you can get him the $15. Get a kit. He'll think that's pretty special. And by the way, I'm going to tell you how it can cost $10 in just a second. But if there's a special man in your life, look at this. This is the kind of the Harry's gift set. Yeah, keep it on this because I want to show everybody how beautiful this is. By the way, you get this great gift box. You get the monogramming, and you get the new, this is the Winter Winston with a copper-handled, beautiful razor. Great look and feel. And as with all the Harry's kits, you get three Harry's blades. You get the great Harry's travel cover, which, you know, you may think, well, it's just a piece of plastic. That thing is really, keeps you from getting cut. When you open up your brand new Harry shaving kit, oh yes, you can get this as part of it too, and your choice of shave cream or the Harry's foaming shave gel. Now, if you're not sure which to get, I like the shave cream. It's so smooth and soft and gives you a really great shave. You know, 1 million guys have now made the shift to Harry's. Easy-to-use website, takes less than 30 seconds to place an order. Be great to get all your manly holiday shopping done at harrys.com. And everybody will be happy, including you, because the price is right. The Winter Winston set, $30 plus. Then you can get engraving. It's a limited edition. Beautiful. Just beautiful. And you could take $5 off your first order with Harry's and free shipping for the holidays. That ends soon, so do that now. When you use the offer code TWIT5 at checkout, $5 off with the offer code TWIT5. But free shipping for the holidays ends December 10th. So what, that's like 3 days, 4 days. So waste no time. Love it. You will love it. If you don't have Harry's yourself, get it for yourself. Harry's.com. Harry's for the holidays. It's Harry's for the holidays. So was this all BS? It was started with the Wall Street Journal article saying that the Yahoo board was going to meet earlier this week to decide what to do with the business. They might, in fact, even sell it. One of the issues was they did have a plan to spin off the Alibaba investment, which that's worth billions, and maybe even Yahoo Japan, also worth billions. But then the IRS would not guarantee that that would be a tax-free transfer. So some of the investors went, ooh, hold on there a little bit. So now they're thinking maybe we just sell the whole damn thing. They're going to halt the Alibaba, perhaps, according to the Wall Street Journal, halt the Alibaba spinoff and sell the internet business. This, of course, coming from the activist investors on the Yahoo board now. Most of the value of Yahoo, it's got $31 billion in market cap, but most of that value is Alibaba and Yahoo Japan. $32 billion worth for its 15% stake in Alibaba, which Alibaba is kind of like the Amazon of China, right? Is that the best way to describe it?
Yeah, fair. I think that's fair.
Yeah. And in fact, you can use it here. I know a lot of people use it here. And it has a
The Yahoo business, right, according to the numbers that you've got, right, is literally less than the sum of its parts.
Yeah. Is like, that weird?
All the bits separately are worth more than its current total market cap. Like, it's totally nuts.
So, and that's what puts it kind of upside down, right? The stock market values it at $31 billion. The Alibaba stake's worth $32 billion if they just sold it. The Yahoo Japan stake, $8.5 billion if they just sold it. And they have cash and investments totaling $5.9 billion. But it's only worth $31 billion, so that's what puts a company in play when it's something like that.
And it's pretty clear if you look at the share prices it's gone this year, it's like it's not in a good place.
Down, down, down.
$50. I think the share price is a measurement of Meyer. You know, it's investors saying that they don't believe that she can actually steer the company without the buffer that she has with all these really valuable assets. So that's fine, and it's great that the market thinks that, and it's great that a bunch of activist investors may or may not have fed a story to the Wall Street Journal. But this is still a decision that's made by the board of Yahoo,
right,
a board which is squarely in Marissa Meyer's corner. You know, these are people, many of whom were handpicked by her. Charles Schwab is a San Francisco luminary and close to Meyer. Scott comes from Walmart. She served on the board of Walmart. They're very tight. You know, I doubt that, you know, somebody like, you know, Scott and David Filo. David Filo is not going to try to push her out.
Right.
I highly doubt that Max Levchin is going to try to push her out. So she has support of people who are making a decision of whether or not she's going to run the place. And then to sell the core business, what would that give her to run? What would she be overseeing, a management company, an investment management company, a stock management company? She doesn't come from BlackRock. She doesn't come from, you know, an investment firm. That's not her expertise. She's not going to do that either. So I really highly doubt we're going to see that happen.
So, you know, there's no story here, in your opinion.
I don't think that there's no story. I mean, the board it has a fiduciary responsibility. It's a jargony way of putting it, but it just means that they are responsible for weighing every single option, sort of like CYA, so that if something happens, or that they can prove that they were doing all they could at all times to maximize value for shareholders. So yeah, do they have to have everything on the table and talk about it? Of course they do. But I just don't think they're going to push Marissa Meyer out the door, not anytime soon. And as long as the Alibaba spinoff happens, that's a lot of money for them. So I don't know. I just don't see her getting canned in 2015 or even early 2016. That's just my read.
Loyalty only goes so far. I mean, yes, of course, these guys are in her corner. But at some point, if the company is the stock market says the company is worth $31 billion and you've got assets 50% worth 50% more, do you have a choice? I mean, at some point, these activist investors are gonna start waging a battle over this. The good news, if you're Marissa Meyer, is according to USA Today, she's got a pretty hefty severance package.
Yes, if they fire her, they have to give her like $158 million, which also makes firing her seem like
even
a very
harder.
Yeah. Very hard because, one, it's very pricey to do, and two, can any of you think of anyone sane who would go run Yahoo right now?
Right. $3 million in severance, $66 million in accelerated stock, $88 million in accelerated stock options. So it's $157.9 million. But only if she gets fired. Or there's a, and I think there's a triggering clause if there's a transfer of ownership as well. Nice work if you can get it. Can Marissa Meyer turn around Yahoo? That's the other question the board has to be asking. What does the future hold? Anybody?
Well, I think under, you know, as much as we all derided the management prior to Marissa Meyer, there was a really clear goal for Yahoo, which was kind of taking the AOL route of trading in its existing business for a media business, right? For building an ad-funded business that owned lots of media assets, traded off its enormous scale, page views, brand recognition, etc. She didn't really want to go in that direction and wanted, you know, it to be a tech business, right, rather than necessarily a media business. So most of the media assets have slightly kind of stumbled and dwindled. And apart from acquiring, you know, something like Tumblr, which is enormous but kind of financially not exactly exciting, she hasn't really sort of put anything in place where you go, well, I can definitely see where you're going with that. They've done a lot of acqui-hires in terms of bringing in talent, but you know, there was a great article I saw a couple of weeks ago about you know, acqui-hires can be terrible for everybody else that works there, because you sort of realize that you've been working, you know, if you're an engineer at Yahoo, you've been working for however many years and you're getting paid X, and the guy next to you has been working there for 3 months and has just cashed out, you know, 10 million or something. Yeah. It's sort of totally demotivating. So I'm not really sure that she's put in a, you know, really a vision that anybody maybe outside her inner circle kind of really understands.
I don't think it's too early to say that whatever strategy Meyer had has failed. And it may, in fact, be that she didn't have a coherent strategy. I mean, I'm not sure I saw anything, you know, from Yahoo. I've seen anything in Yahoo in the last 3 years that looked like it had even the remotest chance of changing Yahoo's fate. Their Flickr app redesign? I don't think so.
Well, it's tough because she inherited a lot of stuff that would have been potentially successful if they had moved faster earlier,
yeah.
But it was too late, like Flickr being right. A good example. Flickr probably could have been Instagram, but they didn't. It
they
wasn't.
Didn't see that. But how often does that happen?
And they buy these things and then they yeah. kind of abandon them. And so I don't know what she was supposed to do. The content strategy might have done something. But yeah, when people talk about Yahoo now, they're saying the same things they said when she got hired, which is Yahoo still around and what does it do?
It seems like nothing has happened. Other words.
And things have happened, but in the end, it hasn't changed anybody's perception of it. It's not like they did something radical right. and broke it apart and turned it into something like Google with a bunch of products and services, nor did they turn it into a media machine that could take advantage of their huge audience. Because Yahoo still has a pretty large audience. It's just not a cool audience. It's a very non-technical, older right. kind of audience. Yahoo, in fact, I hate to say this, but it's more like a newspaper than any yeah. other site on the internet. It's yeah. got an older audience, and it's got a really broad general audience, which is nice, yeah. but it's not exciting, and I think not necessarily a growth area.
Well, and
right?
also, web pages, I hate to say it, but they're going the way of the newspaper, aren't they? I mean, I love the web, but it's all about apps now, right? How much time right. do people spend in the web versus how much time? This is a Yahoo property, TV.com.
Hey, look, there's Doctor Who. We've come all the way back around.
I don't even see any ads on here. Oh, actually, because I have an ad blocker.
Well, yes, again, that's part of the.
That's part of the problem too.
Lots of stuff's inside apps, and it's apps and services, and we really, I think, expected that there'd be more of that, and they do have Tumblr, and Tumblr is a really interesting business.
Tumblr.
But you'd expect them to have broken, you know.
I see a lot of ads on Tumblr now. I have to say.
It's yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what their business is. I think that's the problem. Is they're so big and they have so many. Legacy businesses, and they are not like killing products fast enough or spinning them out fast enough. And
if you wanted
know,
to know
tough,
what was
tough job
happening with celebrities, would you go to yahoo.com/celebrity or TMZ? I mean, I feel like in every respect, I mean, this is
right. This is the newspaper, though. It's like a little bit
like
of everything instead of being focused. And
yeah.
I would like to think that there is a place on the internet for people who are not, you know, solely focused on celebrity news to get a little celebrity news, but that may not be the case. That something of general interest like Yahoo is just not the way the world works.
Should
now.
Turn off my ad blocker because there's a lot of white space on this page. Let me refresh.
This reminds me a lot of Dell because I just that was a company that clearly needed a big strategy shift away from PCs, and it never really got it done. Right, it never really got into services. It bought Pro Systems. It did a lot, but it was never bold enough.
Yeah.
Michael Dell was never a bold enough leader in that way because, you know, there was something about the core he didn't want to let go of or change substantively. Yahoo seems similar. You've got Meyer making a lot of decisions around the margins. Let's do a TV show. Let's do magazines, online magazines. You know, let's bring in all this talent, but never making a bold decision
yeah.
with any of that stuff. Saying, you know what? We need to really utilize Tumblr in a real way. All Tumblr does is give them enough engagement that they haven't been totally abandoned by advertisers.
Except if you look at what Dell has done recently, right? The one thing that Michael Dell suddenly did, which was like, oh my, you know, you sort of realize what's
bold.
Going on. Is that took the company private, right?
Yeah.
Right.
That was a bold move.
Private.
And now they're buying EMC for the largest tech acquisition in history. He got bold. I don't know where that bold came from, but he found his bold.
He went private, so he wasn't being scrutinized by shareholders.
Right. Right.
And the move to buy EMC is actually a move that Kevin Rollins, during his teensy brief tenure as Dell CEO, had also wanted to do for about a quarter of the price.
Oh, whoopsies.
But at the same time, you're right. He did finally start making those moves. Is that what we'll take at Yahoo? Will Yahoo have to go private and be outside of the public eye in order for Meyer or whomever.
That's actually an interesting. If since they do have assets greater than their stock market value, I wonder if there would be a way for them to go private.
Sure. I mean,
that'd be interesting.
If they were to sell off Alibaba and Yahoo Japan, physically the company in terms of its size is much smaller. And then, yes, a buyout shop like a Silver Lake could raise enough, borrow enough money to take the thing private. In theory, that would work.
Interesting. Well, but thank you for that dose of reality. That was probably that Wall Street Journal story was probably planted by the activist investors who wanted this to happen, not necessarily what was going to happen. Still a challenge. I think we all have a soft spot, at least those of us of a certain age have a soft spot in our heart for Yahoo. It was the first search engine I ever used.
Yeah.
Akebono.stanford.edu. And it was a pretty amazing thing for some time, but
when the web was small enough that you could have a directory of what was on the web.
A human-powered directory.
Yeah, instead of a search engine at all. People
going, nice new site. Let me type that in. Hey, if you missed anything, we'll take a little break. If you missed anything on Twit this week, we had some great stuff. Here is a little synopsis we put together. So, sort of the cliff notes of this week on Twit. Watch.
Previously on Twit.
What the heck is this? Why is it a set of legs in the microwave? Makes no sense.
Oh, I made it to the adventurer's path.
Triangulation.
Because we've got some great guests today and a great topic. Developers and people behind two of the most popular ad blocking utilities out there.
It's interesting, for instance, that they spend more resource and more effort on trying to force ads onto the visitors of their site rather than coming up with alternatives, maybe alternatives that fit their site better.
The new screensavers.
Hey, it's Aaron Newcomb. Hello, hey. Aaron.
Hey, good to be here.
So you're a maker.
Yes.
And you built with your 3D printer, this is a little inception, a 3D scanner so you can 3D print things you 3D scan.
That's right.
This week in Enterprise Tech.
China claims arrest in the OPM hack, claims it was criminal activity, not state-sponsored. So great. This means that I need to get my old federal records from the Chinese criminal overlords and not the Chinese government. Much better.
Twit. Say hello to the NSA. They're listening.
Do we have a week ahead? Nope. Couple more stories. I'll tell you what, let me do an Audible ad, and then we'll come back with a couple more stories and wrap this up. Katie Benner is here from the New York Times San Francisco Bureau. I'd want to be clear about that. Jason Snell is also here from sixcolors.com, theincomparable.org. What else you want to plug?
I don't know. Relay FM.
Relay FM. I hate those guys. They're stealing our thunder.
It's a little tiny operation.
Okay, then
they don't even have an office.
I don't hate them anymore. Oh, they don't have an office.
They don't even have an office.
Oh, well, I like them now.
A couple guys
I like
in their pajamas.
What could possibly go wrong? Actually, Relay does a lot of great stuff and shows with many of the people that you might hear from time to time on Twit, including Andy Anako. Mike Hurley's been on Twit himself, and some guy named Jason Snell.
Yeah, I got three on there now.
Three?
Yeah.
Really, three?
Yeah, it's Clockwise, which is our 30-minute tech podcast, quick hit. Upgrade, which I do with Mike Hurley, which is the like traditional people talk about tech for 2 hours kind of show. And then Liftoff, the space podcast.
Oh, a fortnightly podcast about space.
Yeah.
Ooh.
That one's fun. We go into space every 14 days. Then we come back because you can't breathe in space.
Yeah. You could tell that Hurley's British, though, because I don't think anybody in the U.S. would say fortnightly.
Yeah, I pushed for that.
You did?
Because biweekly, it's unclear whether it's every 2 weeks or twice
fortnightly.
A week, right?
Yeah. It's not unclear, it's just obscure.
It's fun. It's fun to say fortnightly.
Fortnightly. Speaking of fortnightly, here he is. He's built a fort and he lives in it nightly. Will Harris from Kindy Nest, Britain. Hello, Will.
That's terrible.
I should ask for a show of hands in the chat room. How many of you know what fortnightly? Well, you've kind of defined it now. So that's
it's every 14 nights, you see.
Oh, is that where it comes from?
Yeah, that's
14
comes
nights.
Yeah.
Well, now it's not so obscure. Our show brought to you by Audible.com. I love Audible. In fact, I get a new book every fortnight. Well, two books a month. It's kind of the same thing. Huh? I'm sitting here on my two credits going, ooh. So many books. That's why Audible's created the wish list. You know, as we recommend books on our on Audible, we can add them to the wish list. And then you go to the wish list and you think, oh, should I get the new biography of Ian Fleming, The Man with the Golden Typewriter? Oh, that sounds good. Or, because The Man in the High Castle is now an Amazon original, should I reread the Philip K. Dick novel? Or how about Glyn John's autobiography? He's the sound guy to the Stones, the Zeppelin, the Eagles, the Who. Chrissy Hynde's My Life Is... These are all books on my wish list. That's the problem with Audible. There's so many great books. And one of the nice things about being an Audible subscriber is those books are in your library forever. I've been a subscriber since 2000, 15 years. I have hundreds of books in my library. I can go back and listen. And I just love it. The Best of 2015 is out. If you're looking, I'm going to get you two books free. Let me explain this. If you're looking for a book, how about this deal for today's deal? Don't get this for your free book because it's only $3. The Dorito Effect, The Surprising New Truth About Food and Flavor. Interesting. The Harry Potter series. Jim Dale's reading of the Harry Potter series is incredible. I just got this order. Yeah, I just got this. The History of the Ancient World from the Earliest Accounts to the Fall of Rome. Part of a new series that's going to tell the stories of all peoples from the very distant past to the present. That's going to be a bit of reading ahead. Look, here's the deal. You're going to get two free books when you go to audible.com/twit and the number two. That's because you'll be signing up for the Platinum account. That's two books a month, but your first month is free. You get also the Daily Digest, both subscriptions, all the subscriptions. You get the Daily Digest of the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times, your pick. Katie's articles often show up in that. They're read to you, which is nice. You can also cancel in the first 30 days, and you get to keep those two books forever. They're yours. I don't think you'll cancel, but I understand sometimes people go, well, I don't know. Am I going to like being read to? Who doesn't like being read to? I love being read to. And these aren't just your average readers. They're some of the best actors and readers in the world reading some of the best books. Oh, I want to get this. And it's Ta-Nehisi Coates' Between the World and Me, a letter to his young son. Which award did he win? The Booker Award? I can't remember. He won maybe a Pulitzer for this big prize, and he narrates it, which is going to bring this to life. You know what? I'm putting that in my cart for sure. So here's the deal. Go to audible.com/twit2. Your first two books are free. Pay nothing if you cancel in the first 30 days, and you can keep it forever. Fiction, nonfiction, science fiction, it's great for that. Radio theater, yeah, they got quite a bit.
They do.
Some of these books are dramatized, too, which makes it a lot of fun. You know, my favorite dramatized one is a Neil Gaiman. They have so many great Neil Gaiman books. I love Neil Gaiman. By the way, if you get the ones that Neil reads, he does Neverwhere, I think he reads. Yep. Really great.
But that's a good one.
Isn't it good? And he reads it. And they made a BBC series out of it and so forth, but he reads it. But this is one of my favorites. It's American Gods. They did a full cast production on its 10th anniversary. Isn't it a great novel?
Yeah, it really is.
He did it. It's hard to describe. The old gods are having a hard time in the new world.
It's about immigrants, and so the immigrants to America bring their gods with them, but
right.
they don't have the history and the tradition that they
Perfect.
Had back, and they're mixing with other gods from other places. Yeah.
And it's dramatized. It's wonderful. If you like Terry Pratchett, I don't know if people know this, but he did a book with Neil Gaiman called Good Omens that is hysterical.
Very funny.
All the Neil Pratchett novels are there. There's so much stuff. I don't know where to begin, and you won't either, but pick two. I just got this new one. Is this it? No. Sarah Vowell, who has the quirkiest voice ever and is hysterical, you've probably heard her on This American Life, has a new book about Lafayette. Lafayette in the somewhat United States. And the readers on this, John Slattery from Mad Men, Nick Offerman
from Parks and Rec,
Fred Armisen from Saturday Night Live, John Hodgman is another one. I just got this one. I'm so excited. Can't wait to listen. You can see I love Audible. You'll love Audible too. Get your first two books free, audible.com/twit2. Do you listen to audiobooks, Will Harris? Seems like you would be an audiobook reader.
I do. I love a good audiobook. I commute quite a lot, so I love an audiobook and a podcast. And the last one I listened to, I'm completely, completely behind the curve, but I just listened to Tina Fey read Bossy Pants.
Isn't that funny? Oh my God, is that good?
Yeah.
She's great. I just listened to Colin Firth read End of the Affair, and it's amazing. Ooh. He actually won an award for it. He should, if he ever doesn't want to act anymore, he should be a professional audiobook reader because he's awesome. He's really, really good. Yeah. And it's
a wonderful book.
Yeah.
Oh, so I'd love
that right away. See, we're all just advertising for audiobooks.
I know. I'm a huge Graham Greene fan. I've listened to most of his books on audio.
Listen to Colin because he's so good.
Okay, you just gave me another one to put in my cart. Love it. This is part of a kind of an Audible series they're doing where they get great voices reading classic books like The Handmaid's Tale. Claire Danes reads that. Mm-hmm. Dustin Hoffman, Being There, the Jerzy Kosinski book. What a great book. Mm-hmm. If you thought the movie was good, you got to read the book. Oh, man. This is the ad that never ends because we just keep finding new books.
We're just watching Leo shop now. I love it.
So speaking of books, Wally Lamb, he wrote a great book, and I think I listened to it on Audible, called This Much Is True. He's written a number of books. I didn't read his last one, She's Come Undone, because it was too depressing. But actually, that was his first one. I know This Much Is True was good. It was We Are Water that I didn't read. So he is a very, very well-known best-selling novelist, but he's doing something weird. His sixth novel will be not released as a book. It will be an app. What? It's MetaBook is the app. It was founded last year. It specializes in multimedia interactive storytelling. Remember when Stephen King released, he said, I'm going to release a novel chapter by chapter as an audio-only download, or maybe it was an ebook-only download, and it was a miserable failure. He said, I'm never doing that again. Mm-hmm. Have times changed? I don't know. You got a big name. The novel's called I'll Take You There. It centers on a film professor who runs a Monday night film club in an old theater that turns out to be haunted by the ghost of Lois Weber, a silent film era actress. Wow. And by the way, only iOS, not even Android. And you'll have to buy it from the iTunes App Store. Okay.
Is it all at once or in installments?
I think it's all at once.
Wow.
I'll buy it. You know what? Just to see. I'll buy it. I love his stuff. News from the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit. Breaking your employer's computer policy is not a crime. This is actually surprising news because the courts have traditionally upheld the rights of employers when it comes to digital stuff. An employer has to hang up if he picks up the phone and hears you having a personal conversation. But reading your email, no problem. Digital stuff has always been treated as, under the ownership of the employer. This is kind of a creepy case. It comes from the Cannibal Cop case. A New York City police officer was charged with conspiracy to kidnap. He never kidnapped anybody. He wrote fantasy posts on a cannibalism fetish site. And he did it during company time. And he was also charged with violating the policies of the... actually, was charged with the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act for violating the New York Police Department policies about accessing a police database without a valid law enforcement purpose. Now, that's an NYPD policy, but they decided to make an example out of him, and they charged him with a computer fraud and abuse case. He was convicted on all counts. The trial court reversed the jury's conspiracy verdict, saying that you can't really have a kidnapping conspiracy in which no one has ever kidnapped, no attempted kidnapping ever took place, no real-world steps were ever taken to kidnap anybody. It's not really, it's thought crime. It's not a crime to think about it. So the court overturned that one, but they did upheld the conviction under the Computer Fraud Act. Interestingly, though, the Second Circuit has overturned that, saying, we decline to adopt the prosecution's construction of the Computer Fraud Act, which would criminalize the conduct of millions of ordinary computer users. While the government might promise it would not prosecute an individual for checking Facebook at work, we are not at liberty to take prosecutors at their word in such matters. A court should not uphold a highly problematic interpretation of a statute merely because the government says, oh, no, we're never going to use it on Facebook. It's only when the guy's doing something really wrong. So, but this is probably good news. It means that while you could get fired or, you know, reprimanded for breaking your employer's computer policy, at least you can't get charged under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act.
I mean, this is good news, but of course corporate policies aren't crimes. They aren't laws. You can't commit crimes by breaking corporate policies. That's crazy.
And this really points to an overreaching by law enforcement and prosecutors in the U.S.
Computer crime. It's scary.
On this CFAA, because, I mean, that was Aaron Schwartz was charged under the Computer Fraud Act. It's been misused.
Yeah.
So good. I'm glad the court said, wait a minute, hold on.
Yeah, discipline him because he violated your corporate policy, but he didn't break any laws by not doing what your handbook said. It's crazy.
Here's a weird one. How many of you do not have a landline? Will, do you have a landline? You know landline. Katie, do you have a landline?
No.
No landline. Jason Snell, do you have a landline?
Yeah, and we tried to get rid of it, but we still have it because of the Comcast bundle. It was cheaper to keep it.
Okay. You don't want a landline.
Don't want it.
Turns out, according to the Centers for Disease Control, people who have cell phones but no landlines are more likely to binge drink, mm-hmm. more likely to smoke, mm-hmm. more likely to be uninsured. You guys are losers.
I think that just describes young people.
There's a demographic
that skews toward not having landlines.
That was a test of your ability to think, and you passed, Katie Bennett. Turns out the CDC, I didn't know this, but the CDC does a kind of a census every year. 40,000 people are interviewed, and because they want to talk to everybody, they go house to house. They don't do it by phone. So they were able to compile these statistics. Look at this. More people are cell phone only than have landlines in the United States. 47% are cell phone only. 42% have both, like you and me, Jason, have landline and cell. Only reason I have a landline is for my burglar alarm. I don't use it. I wouldn't have it. Why do you need one? You got a cell phone. There are 8% in the United States who do not have a cell phone but have a landline. Probably the older people mm-hmm. and the very poor. But yeah, isn't that interesting? I think actually that's the statistic that's more interesting. Now, there are more people don't have a landline than do. Actually, that's not strictly true because if you add landline and cell phone to landline, no cell phone, you get 50%. But it's close. It's neck and neck.
Yeah, this is, as we're going into a presidential election year, this is something to keep in mind. The pollsters are better at it than they used to be, but the entire polling industry was predicated on this idea that you could reach people at a certain time at a number that was a location.
Yeah.
And that meant a landline. And while they were all trying to grasp the right way to poll with cell phones, it's been an issue, and it may continue to be an issue, where the kind of people they want to reach who do vote— but if they can't reach them at a statistically accurate level, you end up with distorted polls.
Well, you understand the young people. For
exactly.
Yeah. So in the last UK election, which was earlier on this year, the polling that took place was statistically the worst on record in terms of accuracy.
They thought Donald Trump would win. That's the amazing thing.
But they said universally it's because it's getting harder and harder and harder to poll people because of the landline problem. And we're seeing that now in the UK, and there's no signs from any of the polling companies over here, like the YouGovs or whoever, that it's going to get any better.
Good. Because polls suck. Well, because they make all the coverage of elections a horse race coverage, right? Mm. Who's winning at the, you know, who's, and he's coming around the turn. It's Donald Trump. That's not what elections should be about. We should be just talking about issues, not who's winning in the polls. Finally, I love this article in New York Magazine. They followed up on 10 former viral sensations on how they're doing. Life after the internet. Katie Upton, remember the Miss South Carolina teen who couldn't in 2007
recent polls have
answer a simple
in the
question?
Iraq and such?
Yeah. US on a world and map. I felt bad when I watched this.
I personally believe that US Americans are unable to do so
because...
I know, I'm not even going to go on with this. Yeah. At the same time as you're laughing at her, you realize this is not her finest moment. And in fact, she almost committed suicide. She said, I lost a lot of close friends over it. People I knew since I was 10, people I grew up playing soccer with. One group of girls took me to this party at the University of South Carolina. I walk in, the entire USC baseball team surrounded me and bashed me with the harshest, meanest comments I'd ever heard. Somebody put a letter in her parents' mailbox that said, go die, Katie Upton, go die for your stupidity. Mm. She said, I went through a period of, I was very, very depressed. I mean, a huge, this is actually tragic. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, she went brunette. She was a blonde in this video. And now her biggest problem is people think she's Kate Upton. So, better things. Now, how about this? Mahir.
Mahir.
I kiss you. Remember this one? This is pre-YouTube, so I don't have a video of it. It was a meme, though, right?
Yeah.
He says, he's fine. He's doing great. I'm married. We practice sport, blah, 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 everything. Nothing in my lifestyle has changed after being famous. But he tried to sue Borat. He says, I'm still mad at him. Wouldn't you be? It's disrespect. Without my permission, earning lots of money. This is stealing. I kiss you. He says, Borat is a copy. And then he says, I don't want to descend to their level. I've transferred to the greatest court and greatest judge, Allah. He will make them pay even if they're not aware. Oh, boy. I'm glad I'm not Sacha Baron Cohen. The evolution of the dance guy. He's doing great. Of course he is. He continues, although what's sad is he still has to do that routine. 10 years later, he's still doing the evolution of the dance. Oh, remember the guy, the homeless guy who had this beautiful voice? He says, I only thought I was getting a job at the local radio station. I knew nothing about viral internet sensations or anything. Satellite trucks, CNN, ABC, everybody covering this, looking for an exclusive.
You work for your dollar. Say something with that great radio voice.
When you're listening to nothing but the best of oldies, you're listening to Magic 98.9.
Wow. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Wow. So how's he doing now? I don't know if he's working. I don't know. He's trying to help homeless military veterans, which I guess he was. So I guess he's using his bully pulpit. Remember the wedding dance? I love this. This is a great article, New York Magazine. Charlie bit my finger. They're all grown up. That was 2007. Well, not all grown up. Charlie's 9. They still earn an income from videos. Charlie bit my finger. We have an unwritten rule. If somebody asks to be bitten, Charlie gets to bite however hard he wants. So it's still, you know, he's still biting. Tay Zonday, we know Tay pretty well. He's still around. He was a PhD student when he sang Chocolate Rain. And he's kind of working in the biz. Still has a YouTube presence.
Yeah, I see him around YouTube quite a lot.
Yeah. He's the old man of YouTube stars, right? The Eminence Grease. Chocolate Rain. Leave Britney alone. Had a reality show. An HBO documentary. Has sold 200,000 downloads of his old songs. Deleted his YouTube account in September. Now posts on Facebook. That's the future, kids. The sign language interpreter for Mayor Bloomberg, who was not saying anything at all. She started her own company with 150 interpreters on staff and writes about the deaf culture for the Huffington Post. Actually, she wasn't the one that was... that was a different one that was saying stuff, but she just was really into it. This was actual sign language.
Expected to make landfall sometimes right. Monday.
She's talking about Hurricane Sandy. She's getting more. She's quite entertaining, actually. Coast.
Now, our first obligation is to protect the workers in these areas.
It's fun. It's fun to watch her. David after that. This is fun. So anyway, just so you know, someday I'll be on that list. You will too. Will Harris, thank you for being here. Digital director at the Condé Nast operation over there across the pond in the UK. He's on the Twitter at WIL Harris, 1L. Nice
to see
you. I can
only dream of being an internet has-been.
Yeah, I can't wait to be an internet has-been.
Thanks very much for having me. It's been great fun to come and do the twits.
We won't make it so long next time. We'll have you back soon. Thank you so much for being here. Katie Benner, same to you. By the way, the best voice in newspapers.
Thanks so much.
You're like that guy. You're like
I'm like that homeless guy. Thank you. People say that to me all the time.
Yeah, you're just like him. It's always great to see you. NewYorkTimes.com, NYTimes.com. I'm a subscriber.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. You're going to do more of the, are they going to do more of the 3D immersive video stuff? Because I still have my cardboard.
Yes, I think we have other videos and projects coming up. I think another one was just released, actually. I'll have to double check, but don't throw away your Google cardboard.
No. That actually, I think single-handedly, the New York Times really made immersive video something everybody has had a chance to experience. So that's
right. And there were a million subscribers. A million people suddenly had something that they didn't have the day before.
Yeah. Pretty cool. Thank you, Cater. Cater. I don't know why I called you Cater. Well, you should be called Cater from now on. I think that's Katie Benner. We just shortened it. And just Snell.
Yeah.
Just Snell is here.
Thanks, Leo.
Thank you for coming on. That's Jason Snell is at sixcolors.com. He's at Jay Snell on the Twitter. Thanks to all of you for being here, too. We really appreciate it. It's a real pleasure doing this show each and every week. 3 p.m. It's a privilege for me. I just love it. 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, 2300 UTC. If you watch live, you can be in the chat room at irc.twit.tv. Harass us mercilessly. We love it. You can also be in studio. We had a great studio audience today. Thank you all for being here. Thanks, whoever I brought the fly swatter up, for killing the damn fly.
Still buzzing.
Is it? Didn't get it, huh?
Didn't get it.
If you want to be here and join us in the fight against flies, go to tickets at or email tickets at twit.tv, and we'll make sure we put a chair out for you. We also have on-demand versions of all of our shows available at our website, twit.tv, on YouTube. I think it's youtube.com/thisweekintech. Wherever you find your podcasts. Don't forget, we are looking to put together, and poor Jason, he's got a lot of work to do, put together a best of episode for the week after Christmas. And if you would like to help us, go to twit.tv/best of. Think of the children. Think of Jason's children. They haven't seen Daddy.
There's a lot of editors and producers working on these right now. So
I know. I feel bad, but it's so much fun to see kind of these best moments from the whole year. If you have a memory of something you really liked, like maybe, you know what I would put in there? John C. Dvorak tormenting me with Jolie O'Dell as she gets up and starts to show him how to use Google Maps in the middle of the show. That would be in my list. But what's on your list? twit.tv/best of. Thanks to Jason Howell, the best producer in the world, for joining us, making this show possible. Thanks to you for being here. We'll see you next time. Another twit is in the can.
Amazing.
Golf club.
Doing the twit.